We're in the midst of a huge transformation where our peers, communities, and workplaces are all really melding into one. Welcome to Reimagining Company Culture. My name is Christina Giordano, and I'm a partnerships manager here at AllVoices, and my pronouns are she, her, and hers. Today, I'm excited to welcome our next guest onto the show, Melanie Oberman. She is the Executive Vice President of People at Heap. Melanie, how's your day going?
It's great. I'm super excited to chat with you today.
Yeah, I'm excited to speak with you as well. If you want to share a little bit about yourself for our listeners, including your pronouns, and this could be literally anything, but what has recently brought you joy?
Awesome. I love that question. So my pronouns are she, her, hers. My most recent joy that she's given me more joy than I can ever imagine is my daughter. I just had a baby 5.5 months ago. Her name is Emma Rose, and she has given me immense and endless joy every day as I am getting to know her and seeing her grow and develop. So that's my joy for sure. And in terms of just silver linings during COVID, it's been a wonderful time to be able to spend with her and be able to be home. It's wonderful working from home right now as well. I'm able to take breaks and see her throughout the day and have more time in my day so I don't have to be commuting to the office, and I can use that time to spend with her or to exercise and do work to get my day started. So those are some of the joys and silver linings, I suppose, of this last year.
Those are great joys and silver linings, and congratulations as well on Emma Rose. That's such a good answer. I wanted to ask you too, like how your personal journey has really led you to kind of lead the people team at Heap right now.
Yes, that's a great question. And there's definitely a lot of different factors that have played a role in landing at Heap. And I love Heap. I love my role at Heap, and so happy to be where I am. So right before I started to look for a new role, I had been leading the people team at Jet Black. Before that, I was at Greenhouse. And before that, I started my career in consulting for many years before entering the startup world. And at Jet Black, we were a startup within Walmart. We were founded by Mark Lore and Jenny Fleiss, Mark Lore from Jet.com and Jenny Fleiss from Rent the Runway. We were a startup that unfortunately we needed to shut down right before COVID. And as a result, my team laid off about 300 people at the time. It was definitely one of the hardest times of my career, knowing that people would be losing jobs and we were shutting down what was a really exciting startup for Walmart. When I was looking for a new role, I prioritized a few things. One was a leadership team with a people focus, especially in my role. This is first and foremost important, and I wanted to find a team that really believed in people. Second was a company that was a Glassdoor awarded culture, because that would mean that the leadership and the company actually walks the talk. They don't just talk about it, but we see the data, we see it in action through the Glassdoor reviews. And last was a product with strong potential in the market. As I, was looking at companies during COVID, I wanted to make sure that I would be at a company that had staying power. And certainly Heap has done all those things and more, for me and for all of the new heaple, as we call them, that have joined the company. And Mateen, who recently transitioned to be chairman of the board out of the CEO position, is really an incredible leader and has such passion for culture and people, and really is the reason that I came to Heap, along with Ken Fine, who's now our CEO, who equally has a strong sense of values, culture, and is very people focused. And I feel very grateful to be part of a leadership team that's led by Ken now. And, you know, I think as I think about my personal journey leading up to this, you know, I mentioned I have a background in consulting. I also have been in the startup world. And I think Heap has a really amazing combination of being a very operations kind of process focused company with a strong vision and product. And if I think about, you know, the consulting world that I was in, there's many elements of that background that I have that I can bring to the table at Heap. And I think, you know, Ken values that type of orientation around, you know, being process focused and very efficient in sort of how we run things, but also, as I mentioned, visionary. And, you know, we have all the elements that tech startups have. So it's kind of a nice combination of my background, you know, leading up to my position here at Heap.
Yeah, absolutely. It sounds like there's a really strong company culture from leadership to the vision to the mission of the company and just with the people in general. And I think part of that staying power too is in communication, especially over this last year. And I know on other kind of podcasts or just interviews you've done, transparent communication is really important. And I wanted to ask you kind of how you see that playing out in practice and how has your communication strategy really changed over this past year, if at all?
Yeah, it's a great question and something that I think about a lot. We're actually adding an internal communications lead to my team because communications is so important in everything that we do, especially in this virtual world. So Heap, for those of you listening may or may not know, is a virtual first company. And so what that means is the primary mode of communication and interaction is virtual. And then we do have hubs in our New York and San Francisco locations. We will be opening a hub in London. And then we meet up as departments and as a global company throughout the year as well. And so during the time that we're not in person, our asynchronous communication is so important. And with that, you know, we're coming up with new ways to do that more effectively. We're looking at, you know, how do we do meetings better? You know, what are ways that we can make sure that we're setting agendas, that we're using templates that help us to collaborate asynchronously during our meetings? And we have an initiative around that so that we're helping all of our leaders of meetings run those meetings more efficiently. Because as you all know, Zoom fatigue is real and having more meetings than we need is not something we want. So we're trying to make those meetings as efficient as we can. So that's one area that we're really focused on. You know, another is just the cadence in which we actually run our all company meetings. So it's important that we all get together on a regular basis. And we do that. We have our engineering, our product and design teams get together on a monthly basis. We have our sales, our marketing, customer success, et cetera, get together on a monthly basis. And then we also have an all company, all hands meeting once a month. We had actually, at the beginning of COVID, had more regular all hands meetings. And we realized that actually we were probably over rotating on that. And so we're trying to figure out now how to have very meaningful, less frequent all hands meetings, and then do more communication asynchronously and on a department and team by team basis as well. So we've had some learnings around that. I think there's definitely a balance we're all trying to figure out between Zoom and asynchronous communication with, you know, a heavy focus for us on more asynchronous communication where we are documenting everything that we possibly can. We use Confluence for our intranet and we document, you know, all of our like processes, our policies on that. We also will answer, for example, our anonymous AMA questions that we will answer during all hands. We do it live, but we also do it in Slack. So yeah, we're trying to make sure that everyone feels included, no matter whether they're able to attend the meeting or not. And so we're figuring all this out as we go. We don't have it all solved, but we also have kind of an experimental team that we've set up to try out different things throughout this quarter and next. We're looking at having, we've been doing no video Wednesdays as one experiment to see how that goes. And we have a bunch of other things kind of in the works that we're going to try out so that we can make our virtual experience as excellent as possible as we, you know, adapt to this new world.
Yeah, I love No Video Wednesdays because I was just talking to someone the other day and we were discussing how it's very unnatural to look at yourself for hours on a day in the Zoom box. And like you said, Zoom fatigue is definitely really real. And it sounds like there's a lot of different strategies and just, you know, testing of different things to make sure that folks definitely feel like they are welcome and included in the meeting too, and just at the company at large as well. I also wanted to ask around kind of Heap's diversity, equity, and inclusion strategy, but first your opinion on what is really important to make sure that folks feel like they are psychologically safe in the workplace, especially in like a virtual first environment. And like that culture of feedback is strong. What are your thoughts there?
It's interesting using the word like psychological safety, because that's something that we use a lot at Heap. And we've actually had managers run psychological safety focus groups with their teams to really dig into this and create more understanding and support as well for our teams. I think the most important thing as we think about an inclusive culture is making sure that employees feel heard and that we're responding. And, you know, a big part of our job as people leaders is just to listen and understand and then figure out how to respond to that. And so as we think actually about psychological safety, this was an element as we were looking at our inclusion scores that was a little bit low for us. And so we've really tried to lean into creating a more psychologically safe environment and doing that on a team by team basis so that we're empowering our managers to, spend time and be vulnerable with their teams on this topic. And we're actually going to be doing some follow-up sessions in the coming months on that.
Oh, that's great. I would love to learn a little bit more about just inclusion and diversity and equity in the workplace as you think about your strategy. Like you said, just like testing out different things to make sure that new folks and people who have been in the company for a while feel like they are part of this one big kind of team.
As we think about diversity, equity, and inclusion, from a diversity perspective, we kind of think of that as all the things having to do with hiring. So from diverse sources to unbiased interviewing, we're partnering with a few different organizations like Fairy Godboss and Jopwell and others to help us with our sourcing efforts so that we can bring in more diverse candidates and ultimately hires. On the equity front, that's more of the like policy and programmatic work, things like fair compensation, fair performance reviews. We've done a lot of work around making our performance reviews more equitable, more fair across the board. We've also made some updates to our parental leave policies where, we want to make sure that our policies are equitable as well for all parents. And so we've done some work in the equity space as well. And then finally, in terms of inclusion, these are more of the behavioral changes that promote a sense of belonging. So we talked a little bit about the psychological safety focus groups, and that's one example of, you know, work around inclusion that we've done. Overall, we have short and long-term goals around DEI. Short-term, we are more focused on things like structured hiring, partnerships, as I mentioned, with relevant organizations around sourcing, more structured performance management, supporting parents, you know, psychological safety focus groups, et cetera. And longer term, we have, you know, some goals and KPIs that we have set and are, I think, pretty ambitious, certainly as we benchmark against other really great companies like Slack and others who have been leaders in the DEI space. And, you know, our ideal vision is of a diverse workforce where underrepresented groups are fully represented and included throughout Heap, including on our leadership team and ultimately, you know, our board as well. And to do that, you know, we want to focus on our leaders and our people managers and our executive leadership due to kind of the multiplier effect there. The idea being that if we can hire people managers and executive leadership, that
are diverse, that this diverse leadership team will lead to a more diverse employee base. And so we've, you know, continued to lean in there as much as we can. And, you know, by the time Heap is 300 employees, we hope that at least 40% of our executive leadership team has leaders who don't identify as male. And we're actually there already, which is great. And so hopefully we can overachieve on that goal. And, you know, by the time we're 600 employees, we're going to expand, you know, some of these goals to our board of directors. And, you know, as we continue to grow, we have more ambitious goals around the representation of people managers and just, you know, ICs as well. So I think it's important to set targets at a company level and then team by team as well, in order to really move the needle in terms of, you know, diversity. Be hiring.
Yeah, absolutely. I think someone used the term achievable but challenging goals too. And I think that's a good benchmark as well. And that's great to hear that you're already kind of achieved that goal in terms of management and things like that as well. And we know that some things are easier to manage in terms of kind of the partnerships that you mentioned with relevant organizations like Fairy God Boss and Jobwell, and just making sure that there's pipeline in the system and all the different policy changes or initiatives, improvements, what have you as well. But everybody is asking kind of how you measure that sense of belonging and inclusion. Do you think of any other kind of KPIs to say we are moving the needle in this way, or just measuring progress? Any kind of advice there for our listeners?
We don't have them set yet, but what we are doing is looking team by team at, you know, census data and then demographic data of the team, and trying to marry those up and come up with goals and targets that way. And so that's something, I don't have the actual targets yet, but it's something that we're working on, and I think will be a really powerful effort and hopefully move the needle for us and potentially for other companies as well.
Yeah, a multi-pronged strategy too. And I think, you know, another part of a conversation around feeling like you belong at a company is that you are seen and heard, like you said too. And there's so much going on, especially with people who just joined the company. They want to make a good impression with people who are there. It's just, they're very invested in the work, and it seems like you're passionate about it as well. So I wanted to ask about kind of burnout and, you know, prioritizing employees' mental health. I heard on another interview about like mental escape or me days. Can you tell us a little bit more?
Yeah. So, you know, as we look just at the world, we've all gone through a lot this year. And so burnout is certainly a theme that we're hearing across the board at companies of all sizes and types. And so it's something we're very focused on at Heap. And one of the initiatives that we put into place actually prior, I guess it was the beginning of COVID, was this idea of a mental escape day, where you could take a day off just to have kind of a mental health day. And it started with this me day concept as, you know, something that would be coordinated between, you know, individual and the team. So if you wanted to take a me day off on a Wednesday, you would coordinate with your team and make sure that that worked. And what we learned over time is that it still was challenging to fully disconnect, because the rest of the company was still running and you were trying to have a me day for yourself, and people were still connected in slacking with other teams, et cetera. And so what we decided is it would be better if we do these me days at a company level. And so we added in at least one me day per month through the end of the year, in most cases more than one. So I'm excited for what we'll be able to do there. And then we're also looking at, you know, team by team, what are some of the friction points that are leading to this feeling of burnout? And so getting really specific, is it, you know, because someone has too many meetings, or is it because like decisions aren't made as effectively as they could be? There's different topics that are coming to the surface that we want to learn more about and dig in on a team by team basis, because I think there's certain efforts we can do at the company level, but this like spreading the peanut butter across the whole company for all the things isn't going to solve, you know, everyone's problems. So we want to really dig in team by team.
Yeah, absolutely. I think team culture is, you know, a definitely important segment of overall company culture, and how you feel like you are contributing to the company, and your manager is a huge part of that as well, in terms of like who you interact with on a daily basis or weekly basis too, one-on-ones, and just team morale. And you mentioned earlier around leaders like really leading with vulnerability and empathy and trainings around there. In your opinion, for effective management, how do you really train managers to be effective? I feel like I say there's born like leaders, there's born visionaries. Yeah. Managers, you need training for people managers.
Yeah,
what do you certainly. What do you get resources?
Yeah, so there's a couple of different ways. I think there's, you know, formal training that, you know, either you can go to or the people team can lead. And then there's, you know, coaching that you can get from your manager. There's coaching you can get from, you know, business partners. And what I like to do when I think about just holistic kind of manager training is I like to bring managers together to talk about what makes a great manager. And what that does is it allows managers that maybe are good, but not great managers to learn from other managers. So what makes a great one-on-one, what makes a great team meeting, and crowdsource these ideas. And so at Heap, we've done a bit of, you know, just kind of manager group huddles where we'll talk about, you know, different topics. And over time, as we continue to level up our manager team, we want to do more of that, where we bring managers together to really learn from each other. And I think that's another way of really leveling up and training your managers beyond the traditional, you know, you can go to a training or the people team can run a training, a manager one-on-one. There's so much value from learning from each other because everyone's figuring this out differently. You know, in the beginning of COVID, as we were figuring out remote work, there were so many great tidbits that managers shared with each other around how they could help their teams to adapt to the new remote world. And, you know, people were able to learn from each other as we brought everyone together.
Yeah, there's huge value in learning from each other too, because you're not the only manager at a company, and just really reflecting on, you know, the great managers that you've had in the past and what works and what doesn't. Having that, again, two-way conversation and fishbowl, if you will, is important. So I love that too. I want to kind of shift our conversation to more of a macro level and just talk about your experience in the industry. So not necessarily Heap specific, but especially when people are trying out different things for the first time, or they're trying to improve upon their dynamic people strategy, some things don't necessarily land. What are common kind of mistakes that you've seen in the employee experience, maybe with the utmost best intentions, but again, didn't kind of meet the expected goal?
I think one of the most important things that a people leader can do is partner with the CEO on company values. It can be challenging to get that right. Where I've seen that gone wrong is if there are values that are rolled out that do not have alignment between the CEO and the people leader and the rest of the org. Ultimately, values need to come from the CEO, and it is super important that the CEO is a believer in the values that are instilled across the company, because we use the values for how we onboard, for how we recruit, and for our day-to-day and how we operate and behave. And if the CEO is not behind those values, it just doesn't work. And it really has a ripple effect, a negative ripple effect across the org. So that's, I think, one of the most important things to get right. And it's not easy to do.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that foundation of values, you can always come back to that framework too, to say, what do we believe in? What do we stand for? What do we want to promote on our company too? And you need to have buy-in from your CEO and also just executive leadership managers. So that's definitely something that is important and a lot of folks are having conversations around too. I guess on the flip side of that is, are there any kind of macro trends that you're seeing in the people space that you're just like, this is something that individuals or companies really need to hone in on to be successful in the future?
The one that comes top of mind is managing this hybrid workforce that we're all trying to figure out right now. So you'll see, you know, there was a trend, I think a few months ago, where everyone was going fully virtual. There were a lot of companies announcing that they would be fully virtual. And now there's the pendulum has swung a little bit, and it's all about flexibility in this hybrid workforce, where, you know, Heap is similar in that we are virtual first, and we will be opening up our offices to have, you know, hubs in our New York, San Francisco, and London locations. And so what that means is, while we are virtual first, we are hybrid because there will be folks that are in the office a few days a week, and then there will be people who are working remotely all the time or most of the time. And so the way that we are working looks different than it ever has. And I think it's a really exciting challenge to figure out. And there's new ways that we're going to all figure out how to make this hybrid work, or this virtual first work, work for all of us. And I think there can be a lot of creativity around that, which I'm excited to lean into.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of creativity and innovation happening, and a lot of opportunity to improve upon things as well for folks in the workplace. We spend so much of our time working, so I think that's really important as well. We really believe in a culture of feedback, and it seems like Heap does as well. So I also wanted to ask you what your best piece of feedback that you have received personally, whether it's as a leader or an individual contributor early on in your career, most recently. What comes to mind?
This is a very simple thing, but it does ring true. And I go back to it all the time, which is to just trust my gut. You know, at the end of the day, this is very simple, but I think the idea that our experience drives, you know, our gut reaction on things. And while data can be very helpful to look at, and we should look at it, there is something about just trusting your gut when making some decisions, not all decisions, but many. And so it's important to look at all pieces of data, but then ultimately use that information to guide your decision and kind of trust your gut in terms of what you're putting forth to move ahead with.
Yeah, I mean, we've been talking about building trust through transparent communication with your manager, company, executives, your team members, but I think that goes to trusting yourself too and trusting your gut, which is an important relationship to have as well in order for everything to be in balance too. And in terms of personal experience, is there anything, like, knowing what you know now and having these experiences, anything or advice you would give to your younger self who is just starting out in your first or second job, out in the field?
Yeah, I think this concept of trust is such an important one. With that, you know, the advice I'd give to my younger self is every decision you make is a good one because you made it. it doesn't matter if you second guess it, you made the decision and there was a reason you made it. So this idea of be confident with your decisions, trust your decisions, because when you look back, they'll likely tell a really great story and you'll land in a place that you never thought you would, but it's going to be right. Because there's an element of just trusting the decision you make because you made it.
Yeah, you made it, you came to that decision and you're going in for it. So, and it does, like, hindsight is 2020, and it does make for a good story. So I agree with you there. Is there anything that I didn't ask that you want to kind of share with our listeners before we end our conversation, or just a key takeaway that you want to highlight for folks who are listening in?
I think as I reflect back on all the questions that you asked, you know, certainly a theme is around this changing world with COVID and just the changing world of work, and also around trust. And, you know, the changing world is going to continue to challenge people leaders. It has been this past year. We've been doing things differently than we ever thought we would, or trying to figure out things that we've never had to be challenged with before. And so I'm really excited to be part of this change. I think there's, we talked about just more creativity and innovation that we can bring to what we do. Yeah, I just want to highlight that because I think there's a really exciting movement in kind of the people space to figure out what this new world of work looks like.
Yeah, absolutely. It's exciting and there's a lot of opportunity out there, and everything is out there. So Melanie, I really appreciate you taking the time to speak with us this afternoon. And it was great to meet you on Reimagining Company Culture.
Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure.
Yes, absolutely. And for our listeners, as a reminder, All Voices believes in the power of all employees to speak up and thinks it's a requirement for folks to succeed. We'll speak soon.